I can't wait to teach you all about Jesus this tonight on this beautiful Good Friday evening. I think we should start having church every Friday evening.
Amen.
Sounds good.
Two amens. I'll take it. I had a lot of conversations with different people just the last couple days, and I've heard sermons on the crucifixion before, and I've never really studied it out in detail before, but I've been depressed this week, but more emotional than anything as I delve into the scriptures and really study out everything that Christ went through for us on the cross. You see, this is an exciting time in a believer's life. It should be. It's confusing for a lot of people, confusing to the world, that we worship a God that left the perfect place to pay for the penalty that we deserved for our sins. A lot of people never grasp that concept. I really want you all to see the crucifixion as not just a story anymore. Okay? I want you guys to see the crucifixion, the time in Jesus' life that he went to an amazing extreme for us because of the great love with which he loved us. The crucifixion is perhaps the greatest portrayal of love that some will never grasp. The greatest portrayal of love that a born-again Christian will ever, ever read about. Ever. Day to day in our lives, we hear stories, okay? We hear gruesome stories. We hear trying stories. We hear stories of children dying. We hear stories of people with terminal illnesses. And whenever we look at these things, we see surgeries that loved ones are having, and we just kind of ponder on them for a minute or a second, and then we go about our day not really thinking about all that goes on during that specific trial in a loved one's life. It's just a story to us. When I was in Teen Challenge, I remember the second month I was there, my dad was having chest problems. And he called me and he said, I'm at the hospital. They're not letting me leave. They're going to have to do open heart surgery. And I said, okay, well, I was in Teen Challenge. I couldn't leave. So I wrestled with that a little bit. But I remember talking to a couple people going, oh, it's just heart surgery. It's okay. I mean, he's not going to die from it or anything like that. So kind of just played it off a little bit. And I don't know if you guys have ever seen, like, Google an open heart surgery one day, okay? This is what happens. They slice you they slice you about 12 inches. They slice your skin open. They take a saw, and they saw your sternum in half. Okay, and then they have these things that connect over here, and they pull your chest apart. Our bones are not supposed to bend like that. And so all of your innards are exposed. Well, we can just chalk it up as it's just heart surgery. Never really thinking about what takes place. One of Brianna's friends, her dad is a firefighter, and he said he got in a car wreck, and he was walking across, he had some leg pain, he was walking across the parking lot, and he fell down and snapped his femur in half. He told me the story, and I cringed. But that's it. That's the most painful bone to break in your body. And every step for the rest of his life, he's going to be reminded of. Every time he gets out of bed, he's going to be reminded of it. But as I was talking to him, ooh, I'll pray for you. That was it. Guilty. So as I extract from all four of the Gospels in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we see a story that we overlook and we chalk up just to a few words. Just to a few words. We don't really ever think about the pain that Jesus endured for us on the cross. The Bible says it so simply. And they crucified him. That's it. And then they crucified him. But those words don't even begin to convey the horror that Jesus endured for us on the cross. Consider the fact that he arrived in Calvary He was probably awake all night. He had been through at least four trials, been beaten by the Jews, beaten by the Roman soldiers. And when I say beaten by the Roman soldiers, I heard a sermon one time, and I've read a couple books on Roman soldiers. They look like, they make Nazis look like saints. Okay? These Roman soldiers are gruesome. Whenever people get crucified, sometimes they have other people crucified on a road as they're carrying their, whatever they're getting crucified on, down the road. Rotting carcasses, I mean, crows like eating inside people's heads and stuff. Like, these guys were brutal beyond brutal beyond brutal. And they crucified him. That's all that we see. He was mocked, he was ridiculed, he was spit upon and made to carry his cross up Calvary. And then Jesus was crucified. An act more horrible than anything that you and I could ever imagine. Let me give you a brief description of what happens. I found some pretty gruesome ones, but this is one that isn't so bad that you still get the full effect from. What is crucifixion? A medical doctor provides a physical description of what happens. Okay? I really want you guys to really ponder on these words. Really think about what goes on whenever someone is hanging from a cross. Cross is placed on the ground, and an exhausted man is quickly thrown backwards with his shoulders against the wood. The legionnaire feels for the depression at the front of the wrist. They don't crucify people through their hands, because when they did, it would just rip out. So what they do is they crucify in between the radius and the ulna. So when you hang, there's something to hang on to that they don't rip off. Okay? He drives a heavy, square wrought iron nail through the wrist and deep into the wood, quickly moves to the other side and repeats the action, being careful not to pull the arms too tightly, but to allow a little bit of flex. The cross is then lifted into place. The left foot is pressed backwards against the right foot, and with both feet extended, toes down, a nail is driven through the arch of each foot, leaving the knees flexed. The victim is now crucified. As he slowly sags down with weight on the nails in his wrists, excruciating, fiery pain shoots along the fingers and up the arms to explode into the brain. The nails in the wrists are putting pressure on the median nerves. As he pushes himself upward to avoid the stretching torment, he places the full weight of the nails through his feet. Again, he feels the searing agony of the nail tearing through the nerves between the bones of the feet. And the arms fatigue, cramps sweep through every single muscle in your entire body, not even deeply, relentless, throbbing pains. With these cramps comes the inability to push himself upward to take a breath. Air can be drawn into the lungs, but cannot be exhaled. He fights to raise himself up in order to even get one small breath. Finally, carbon monoxide builds up in the lungs and in the bloodstream, and cramps partially subside. Spasmatically, he is able to push himself upward to exhale and breathe in life-giving oxygen. Hours of limitless pain, cycles of twisting, joint-rending cramps, intermittent partial asphyxiation. Ask the doctor what that means. Searing pain as tissue is torn from the lacerated back as he moves up and down against the rough timber. Then the agony begins, a deep, crushing pain deep in the chest as the pericardium slowly fills with serum and begins to compress the heart. It is now almost over. The loss of tissue fluids has reached a critical level. The compressed heart is struggling to pump heavy, thick, sluggish blood into the tissues. The tortured lungs are making a frantic effort to grasp in small gulps of air. He can feel the chill of death creeping through his tissues. Finally, the crucified person can allow themselves to die. All this the Bible records with the simple words, "And they crucified him." What an amazing love that it was that he endured because of his love for us. We're going to read one of the gospel accounts of the crucifixion of Mark, chapter 15, if you want to turn your Bibles there. But leading up to this moment, we see a few different events occur. On Sunday, we see Jesus his entry into Jerusalem. Monday, Jesus flips the tables over and clears the temple. Tuesday, Jesus' authority is challenged in the temple, and Judas agrees to betray Jesus. Thursday is the Last Supper. Jesus speaks to his disciples in the upper room and preps them for what is coming. Jesus also prays in the Garden of Gethsemane that we learned about last week. Jesus is betrayed and arrested, and so we pick up here with Jesus in front of Pontius Pilate. Starting at verse 12, Mark 15, and Pilate again said to them, "Then what shall I do with a man you call the King of the Jews?" And they cried out again, "Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Why? What evil has he done?" They shouted all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released for them Barabbas. And having scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. Verse 16. And the soldiers led him away inside the palace, and they called together the whole battalion. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, twisting together a crown of thorns, and put it on his head. They began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they were striking his head with a reed and spitting on him and kneeling down in homage to him. When they had mocked him, they stripped him of his purple cloak and put his clothes on him. And they led him out to crucify him. And they compelled the passerby, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from another country. And they brought him to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his garments among them, casting lots for them, and decided what each of them should take. And it was the third hour when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two robbers, one on his right, one on his left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads, saying, "Aha! You who would destroy a temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from that cross." So also the chief priests and the scribes mocked him to the one another, saying, "He saved others, but he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now off that cross, that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also reviled him. Verse 33, "And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. The ninth hour, Jesus cried out," I may butcher this, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Some of the bystanding hearing it said, "Behold, he is calling Elijah." And someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Jesus uttered with a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood facing him saw that the way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man is the Son of God." There were also women looking from a distance, among whom were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, the younger of Joseph, and Salome. When he was in Galilee, they followed him and ministered to him. And they were also with him and other women who came up to him in Jerusalem. Pray with me. Father, we love you. We praise you, Father, for this amazing evening, Father, to delve into your word, to see exactly what happened that day. Father, I ask that you open our hearts and open our minds, that whenever we look at the crucifixion from this day forth, that we see it differently. Help us, Father, every day. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Like I said earlier, I want to extract from all four of the Gospels and attempt to accomplish a couple things here tonight, okay? One being the significance of the words that Jesus said while he was hanging on the cross, and why the cross was even necessary. Okay? Jesus uttered seven different sentences over the course of a few hours during this excruciating crucifixion. And what I want you to see is who he was speaking to. His heart condition at the very time he was speaking, and why he said what he said, and what we can take away from it. Before we get into the crucifixion, I want to talk about his walk of him carrying the cross, and something that you may have overlooked in Scripture before. We see a man who's mentioned one time in Scripture, Simon of Cyrene. It's not even mentioned in all four of the Gospels, okay? Right before Jesus was crucified, during that painful walk up Golgotha, we don't know much about Simon, but we can learn a couple things from him, okay? We can learn a couple things. We see a man who saw an injustice being done, a man who saw someone being treated unfairly, who literally could not stick up for himself at all, and he jumped up and he stood up for righteousness, what he thought was right. And when Simon did, what happened? What happened? He was forced to do the very thing that we all struggle to do daily. He picked up and carried the cross of Jesus Christ. Something that we all struggle with every day of our lives. He picked up and carried the cross of Jesus. How amazing how it had to have been for this man after it all played out. After the story comes to a conclusion. Simon came face to face with the living God, bloody beyond recognition. Looked Jesus Christ in the eyes and helped him carry the cross that some of us find so hard to pick up from day to day. When the pieces were put together soon thereafter, what an honor it had to be to walk side by side with the Son of God. Looking him face to face, the one who would rescue every single person in this room from their sins one day, he got to walk side by side with. You see, did he know he was working for the Son of God at that exact moment? The Bible doesn't say a lot. It's not specific about that, but what I do know is this, is that we never know when we're working for God. He didn't know at the time that he was standing up for the Son of God. He just saw something that was wrong. You see, the Word of God states that our lives are a living epistle to be read by all. So, you're always witnessing for Christ somehow, some way, whether that be a bad witness or a good witness. You're either standing up for him or spitting in his face, but you are witnessing for him. Our lives are a living epistle to be read by all. There's always someone listening. There's always someone watching. You may be having a conversation with someone and not know that you're witnessing to the person in back of you. You never know. So learn and take away from this little story of Simon, okay? So from Simon of Cyrene to Jesus on the cross. Jesus' final hours on the cross probably lasted from the walk to the crucifixion about 6 hours. And we're going to break down Good Friday's events as recorded in Scripture, including the events just before, okay? Many of the actual times of these events are not recorded in Scripture, but there is reference to what hour of the day it was. And by pulling from all the Gospels, we can get rough estimates of when this stuff was taking place within this 6 hour span. Again, we see the 7 sentences uttered by Jesus as he hung on the cross. Some statements showing the human side of Jesus, and some showing his divinity, his power, still portrayed as God hanging on the cross. The first words of Jesus to hung on the cross baffled me to no end. After he was beaten and tormented for close to 12 hours probably, Jesus looked down from the cross after he was crucified between 2 criminals. Jesus sees the soldiers that mocked him, that spit on him. He sees the soldiers that beat him, who jammed a crown of thorns on his head. And this is the first words we hear from our script and from our Savior. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Probably remembering Caiaphas and the high priest of the Sanhedrin to the apostles who denied him and deserted him. Speaking to everyone. How would have you reacted? In hatred? In anger? That you have done nothing wrong at all. And still, this horrible injustice is being done to you. We see a perfect example of forgiveness to an extent that we can hardly grasp or wrap our head around. Some would say, he could only do that because he was God. I say no. Let me point you to something else. Acts 7, the stoning of Stephen. After he was being stoned, listen to what he says at the end. Lord, do not hold this sin against them. We need to realize, being faithful followers of Jesus Christ, that we are going to face persecution. Maybe not to this extent, but we're going to go through it from time to time. Standing up for Christ isn't a popular thing in this day and age. We're going to face being treated unfairly. And being a faithful follower in Christ, you will not act or react like the world. And here are two perfect examples of this, that they instilled grace and forgiveness when it was never deserved. Jesus poured out forgiveness to even the ones who were killing him for no reason. Are you instilling that kind of forgiveness and grace in your lives from day to day? The second word from Jesus on the cross could only come from the Son of God himself. Again, another amazing act of grace as he hung on the cross. We see here it's not just the religious leaders and soldiers that mocked Jesus, but even one of the criminals was mocking Jesus that he was hanging with. We see another one who sees Jesus for who he truly is. I believe a measure of faith was instilled by God in this exact moment as this criminal held was hanging on the cross next to Jesus. One of the criminals speaks out, "This man has done nothing wrong." And turning to Jesus, we see a repentant sinner look to Christ for the first time. Look to Christ for the first time. He sees the beauty that Christ portrays. He sees him as his Savior. Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And what does Jesus say? Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Today you will be with me in paradise. I can only imagine how beautiful it would have been to hear Jesus speak those words to someone. Hanging on the cross like that. To hear the Savior of the world say that you will be with me for eternity. You see, this was a word of forgiveness. This time directed to a sinner in need of a Savior. Jesus shows his power, his divinity, still hanging on the cross. By opening up heaven for a repentant sinner in front of everybody. An amazing generosity Jesus portrays to a man who only requested to be remembered. Grace, mercy, forgiveness again is portrayed here. The third word from Jesus. Families, listen to this one. John is the only gospel writer to record these words and also the only eyewitness at the crucifixion, okay, of all of the gospel writers. Most of us have families. Most of us have kids. If not, I'm sure that you have children that you love in your family somehow, some way. When I try to put myself at the base of the cross, it's heart-wrenching. I'm going to take that a step further for you. Can you imagine your son or daughter who was completely innocent, hanging, crucified, bloodied beyond recognition, speaking to you, hanging from a cross? The sorrow that must have filled Mary's heart to see her son that way. But again, Jesus does something completely selfless. Once again, he directs the attention off of himself and his only concerns for the ones who love him. Jesus is only concerned about somebody caring for his mother. Jesus says to his mother, "Woman, this is your son." And he says to his disciple, John, "This is your mother. Take care of her." His only concern was not that he was dying on a cross. It was never for himself, but to take care of his mother. Another selfless word from our amazing Savior as he hung lifeless on the cross. Never still thinking about himself at all. At all. The fourth word. A cry from a painful heart And I see it as more of the human side of Jesus here. You see, Jesus feels betrayed. He feels deserted by his Father, and not to mention all of his buddies, all of his apostles. Where are these guys in his darkest hour? Nowhere to be found. To emphasize his loneliness at this specific moment, Mark the Gospel writer has his loved ones, and I quote, looking from afar. Looking from afar. So Jesus feels separated from his Father, his family, and now he must face death by himself. The fourth line is the opening words of Psalm 22. The cry from the cross also portrays the cry of Israel in the Old Testament. My God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus, who came to us, is crucified. He realizes the horror of what is happening and what he is now enduring in his body. The full wrath of sin, which we deserve, was poured out upon him. Was poured out upon our precious, perfect Savior, who never did a thing wrong. Paul Washer says, the burden of all the sins of humanity for a moment overwhelmed the humanity of our Savior. Overwhelmed the humanity of our Savior. What one would see as unimportant as an act of why did this have to happen? We see as believers as sufficient. As the greatest portrayal of love in the history of the world. 1 Peter 2:24, he himself bore our sins in his body upon the cross, so that free from sin, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, we are healed. The fifth, sixth, and seventh words I'm going to kind of place together. I see in Scripture these words are placed very closely, but just because they're placed closely, I have a feeling that a minute on a cross probably felt like 6 hours at a time. At this point, they're 3 hours into the crucifixion. The fifth word is one of the only human expressions we see of him because of his physical suffering. Okay, the wounds inflicted upon him, the crown of thorns on his head, the three-hour walk to his crucifixion, and the nail on the cross has now taken its toll. Okay, the Gospel of John refers to this thirst when Jesus meets the Samaritan woman at the well. After first asking for a drink, he answers the woman, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life. You see, this passage implies more than just a physical thirst. There's more to it when Jesus says, I thirst. He's thirst for In a spiritual sense, okay? He thirsts for love. He's thirsting for the love of his Father who has turned his back. He thirsts for the love and salvation of his people. You see, Jesus is practicing exactly what he is preaching all through Scripture. John 15, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no man than this, than he lay down his life for his friends. Jesus literally laying down his life for his friends. The sixth word of Jesus is amazing. I think I've said that about all the words. They put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it to his mouth. You see, John recalls the sacrifice of the Passover lamb in Exodus 12 in this passage, okay? Hyssop is a small plant that's used to sprinkle the blood over the doorposts, or over the blood of the Passover lamb on the doorposts of the Hebrews, okay? John's gospel related all this to the day of preparation, the day before the actual Sabbath Passover, okay? So Christ became the Passover lamb. Christ became the Passover lamb. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 5:7, "For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been crucified." So Jesus finally recognizes that the task is complete and his suffering is now coming to an end. And the 6th and 7th words of Jesus uttered are perhaps the most beautiful words that I have ever seen in Scripture. Jesus says, "It is finished." And with a loud cry, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." This is Psalm 31:5. Jesus entered death in the same way that he lived his life every day, completely submitted to the Father from day one all the way to his death. Not once do we see Jesus taking a break. The only thing that mattered was the will of the Father. And when Jesus uttered these last words, something amazing happens. We're told that the veil of the temple was torn in half, from top to bottom. From top to bottom. We see the veil stood as a barrier between the holy place and the holy of holies in the temple, okay? Behind the veil was the mercy seat, okay? So the high priest would enter behind the veil once a year on the Day of Atonement, place the blood of the sacrifice on the mercy seat to atone for the sins of the people. Okay? The veil stood as a reminder that we are separated from God because of our sins, and we are unworthy to approach God. If you want to read more about that, that's in Isaiah 59. However, when Jesus died on the cross, the veil was torn in two, from top to bottom, signifying that the way to God had been opened through his Son, Jesus Christ. Through his Son, Jesus Christ, that we are no longer separated from God because of our sins. We can now be brought into the presence of a holy and perfect God because of the blood that was shed on the cross. This blood brings sinful man and a holy God together as one. Worship team, I'd like you to come up, or you can just play some music for us. I hope and pray that from this day forth, when you read these words, "And they crucified him." "And they crucified him." That you see it differently. That you see the love that Jesus portrayed to you on that Good Friday. That this was the only way that we are saved from our sins, by trusting in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross. We are going to, this time I want to reflect upon everything that was done on the cross today. The body, the blood that was shed as we take communion. I think Pastor Al and Joe are going to come up. And before we pass out these elements, I say a prayer every time before I take these elements. Psalm 139, 23, 24. "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out everything in me that offends you, and lead me along the path of everlasting life." When we start asking a holy and perfect God to point out everything in us that offends him, some stuff can come up that we may be uncomfortable with. That's the kind of stuff that you need to meditate upon now. There's no sin too great that wasn't nailed to the cross. And as we reflect on the crucifixion, the body, it was broken, literally broken, and the blood that was shed, I hope and pray today that you look at these elements differently for the rest of your life. That today, whenever you read those, those words, and they crucified him. That you see that this is the greatest portrayal of love that anyone could show us.